Being published with a pack of stickers. Because I really have one unicorn stickers and dragon stickers. Cool. Up next we have Molly Schulman. Anyone know Molly? Molly's a badass. She's a writer and an editor. She got her BA in creative writing from the New School, and she has worked in publishing as the in-house editor at the Friedrich Agency. This year she's going to be doing this really cool thing where she's the guest author and instructor at La Ventura Writing Residency in Villa Cantoni in Northeast Italy. And most recently she was the winner of the 2016 Ragdale Writer in Residence, where she got to work on her novel, which is coming out sometime, hopefully real soon. We don't know. It's entitled How to Cry on Cue. Molly?
Thank you, everybody, and thank you, Josh, wherever you are, and your cute kids for being here and opening up the night, and thank you, Zachary, who you guys will hear up next. I am reading from my novel in progress. It is called How to Cry on Cue, and I'm going to read two excerpts. The first is the very first chapter, so it needs no explanation, except for we're in Los Angeles about 15 to 20 years from present day. And I also wanted to open up with a quote that's been really inspiring in the writing of this novel by the late, great David Rakoff, who said, "Only a heartless ogre would fail to be touched by a protective affection for Hollywood. It is trying its best. Hollywood makes you want to take care of it. No business like show business." It was chicken nugget night in the Kirk Douglas dining hall. After dinner, there'd be bingo in the Judy Garland gymnasium and square dancing in the Marlon Brando lounge. Everyone was sleepy. It was hell week for the tenants of No Business Like Show Business retirement community in Woodland Hills, California, about 20 minutes north of Los Angeles. Their production of Bye Bye Birdie was opening in just a few days. Playing the role of Conrad Birdie, the hunky Elvis-inspired character, famous in the fictional town of Sweet Apple, Ohio for his hypnotizing hips, was a man named Sonny Rabinowitz. Sonny was 97 years old and in relatively good health, save for his chalkstone feet, cataracts, and cauliflower ear. People always asked if he had wrestled as a young man. He hadn't. Show business, in fact, had given him that cauliflower ear. After studying theater and working as a stage actor for many years, he landed what would end up to be the very long-standing and very lucrative role of quarterback Chad Bucko on ABC's revered football dramedy series, End Zone. Insistent on performing his own stunts, it was only a matter of time before he began hurting himself. The cuts and bruises healed well enough, but the gnarled, columbinous flesh of his left earlobe was there to stay. A souvenir, he reasoned, snubbed by the Emmys year after year, he joked that his trophy was better. Now at 97, Sonny was so pleased to be returning to the stage, and as Conrad Birdie, the dream role. And these days, he didn't even need a commission-grubbing agent, R.I.P. Harry Kovacs, to close the deal. The casting director, in other words, a day nurse with a clipboard, was dazzled by Sonny's audition outfit, a powder blue leisure suit with gold trim. Sonny's son had brought it to him a few weeks earlier. Sonny's son had become something of a stage mom that week, running lines with his dear old dad, styling his remaining hair with a licked finger. "You're gonna knock him dead, Dad. You've got more talent in your pinky toe than anyone in here." In any ordinary old age home, this compliment by comparison wouldn't mean so much. But here at No Business Like Show Business retirement community, everyone was pretty talented. Or at least they were at a time, when their skin was nice and taut and when they could go to the bathroom unassisted. No Business Like Show Business retirement community was home to former soap stars, former Hollywood execs, gaffers turned gaffers, and mostly working actors, those familiar faces that cropped up in just about every commercial and TV show without ever quite making it. "Hey, it's that guy," viewers would say, excited by the familiarity, but not so excited to actually know who they were excited about. And after years of semi-regular paychecks for semi-regular guest spots on sitcoms, these actors didn't quite have the capital to age in palatial hilltop houses, or perhaps they didn't quite have the support of a large living family, but what they did have was a sustained and dedicated interest and comfort in show business. It was all they knew, the slog of it, the gloss of it. Aged out of the actual business, where better to grow old than with like-minded ex-actors and Hollywood enthusiasts? How better to conclude a life of play pretend than with a play, a production, a powder blue suit and a swivel of the hips? Here at No Business Like Show Business, aging and dying could be just another role, just another series of lines to learn and blocking to block, marks to hit, and lights and angles to find. Like many retirement homes and nightclubs and preschools and building co-ops, it wasn't exactly easy to be admitted to No Business Like Show Business retirement community. Years ago, an audition was required upon entry, but after too many prospective tenants suffered from cardiac overexertion during the dance segment, the board decided that auditions would only be necessary for in-house productions. To apply for general admission, one simply had to submit a resume listing training, representation, current or former, stage and screen experience, and special talents. Also required were two 8x10 glossy headshots, one recent and one from the applicant's proverbial heyday. Proof of Screen Actors Guild membership was needed, or a relevant industry union, current or expired, three industry references, an acting reel or collection of clips, and last but certainly not least, a big fat check. Gail Spiegelman has only one of these requirements. Her husband of 67 years has just passed, peacefully, one assumes, asleep at their home, his houndstooth silk sleeping mask resting over his closed, thin eyelids. And Gail Spiegelman's descent into catatonic lonesomeness has been swift and severe. Despite the many, many differences, arguments, betrayals, secrets large and tiny, and lies large and tiny that accrue over nearly 70 years of marriage, Gail and Jason Spiegelman were as in love at the end as they were at the beginning. Here at the end, Gail is 85 years old and frail and prickly as a splinter. On a good day, some might call her frail and flitty as a dandelion wisp. Today is not a good day. She is applying for residence at the No Business Like Show Business retirement community. Gail has never acted or performed, though, nor has she operated a camera or written a script. She has never directed a play or dressed a set. But if Gail had to age beyond her Jason, she knew just where she'd have to go. Her daughter, Hope, has helped her prepare a fraudulent application. The headshots were easily fictionalized, thanks to the wonders of basic Photoshop, and the professional references were manageable. Hope had been a talent agent for several years and still had some active connections and favors to call in. Hope had also been an actress for several years, a past life, she called it, as it reincarnated. So she had an expired SAG card that could be convincingly manipulated with a bit of whiteout, red ink, a scanner, and a printer. The resume would be tricky and full of lies, but what resumes weren't? When Hope was acting, according to her resume, she was 8 for 4 consecutive years, and she was classically trained in piano, and she was always in pre-production on some unnamed, unannounced, imaginary Woody Allen film. She was also fluent in French and an avid horseback rider. Hope considered listing these same skills on her mom's application, but feared she'd get her accidentally enrolled in some sort of geriatric equestrian activities. Gail would not like that. Gail did not like animals or sports or things that smelled. The acting reel would be toughest to pull off. Movie magic would be necessary. The big fat check, though, Gail had. But wait, this is at the end. Let's go back to the beginning. But where does the beginning begin? It could begin with Hope as a red-headed, red-cheeked toddler starring in her first commercial for Skippy Peanut Butter. It could begin with Hope, age 7, chipping a tooth on a stale craft service bagel and being promptly fitted for an emergency flipper. Perhaps you've noticed this. Child actors rarely have missing teeth, unless, of course, it somehow contributes to their overall quirk or relevance to their role. Think Beverly Hillbillies or the Gogans from Pete's Dragon. This is thanks to the invention of what's called a flipper, which is essentially just a modified denture, a little mouthpiece replete with a single tooth replacement. Clippers are freaky. In any case, these would both be fun openings, full of snippy showbiz lingo and light name dropping, Annette Funicello, Molly Ringwald, Kermit. It could begin with a long and learned history of Hollywood, academic yet tributary, an investigation of the glamour, the garbage, the starry-eyed delusion, Grauman's, earthquakes, locusts, callbacks, the smog. Let's begin, however, loosely and with permission to flow in and out of time, in 1957, with Gail Spiegelman watching her father choke on a beet on Thanksgiving. So that is the opening chapter. As you can tell, it's a novel very much about Hollywood and show business and all the kind of wonders that come with that lifestyle. And this next chapter is flashing back several years to 1984, and Hope, the adult daughter who's taking care of her mom in the previous chapter, she is a child star. She's pretty successful. She's in a chintzy little show that's known as The Robot Show. It's like an 80s sitcom, and she's 7 years old. And Gail has kind of, she's a full-on stage mom. This is her full-time job, sending her little kid out into the world of showbiz. And you also need to know here that Gelson's is a grocery store chain in Los Angeles. Los Angeles, 1984. Michael Jackson shops at Gelson's. Tofu was not trendy in 1984. It wasn't unavailable, but it was deep in the international food section at Gelson's, cuddling up beside the dehydrated kelp and instant shoyu noodle cups. There was no distinction then between firm and extra firm, sprouted and not sprouted. Tofu was simple, mushy and lumpy, and apparently loaded with ancient gut-restoring nutrients. It was packaged in a wet baggie. It was Michael Jackson's favorite food. Despite the four gigantic chested Chicanos shadowing his every move, Michael Jackson insisted on maintaining some teeny tiny semblance of normalcy by doing the grocery shopping on his own. He could regularly be found in aisle 6 sniffing shampoos, or in aisle 2 sniffing cheese wheels. Whether he was interested in buying these items or just testing the limits of his new teeny tiny nostrils, nobody knew. Nobody knew how to act around him either, so astonishingly, they didn't pay him much attention. They let him sniff and shop and playfully stand on the foot of his cart in peace, freewheeling through the yogurts. The Gelson's employees were jazzed at first and later irritated when they saw how much he loved to pull the coupons from the red plastic automatic coupon dispensers and how much he loved to fling them to the linoleum floor, a trail of breadcrumb coupons in his path. He also loved free samples. Cantaloupe chunks on toothpicks, mini paper cups of aloe juice. Though his presence was commanding, he was Michael Jackson, and obstreperous, it was also quiet, silent even, as if scooting through the supermarket was more moving meditation than weekly plebeian errand. This behavior took a turn for the loud, though, when Michael Jackson spotted his favorite actor of all time, her chubby, freckled fingers reaching for a melon. He squealed her name, that is, her character name, on The Robot Show, startling the young girl and toppling the bowl of freebie melon samples to the floor. She didn't recognize him. She was 7, hardly even knew who he was, and wondered why this peculiar Asian-ish man lady was shrieking at her in the middle of Gelson's. She'd only previously experienced fandom a handful of times, at industry events and in the strange, adoring fan letters that she received from Miss Audrey Clemens, the woman from Illinois who loved rabbits and poetry. Frantic, flattered, and a bit unsure of what to do, little Hope turned her attention to the spilled fruit and tried to scoop it up while simultaneously trying to eye her mom, who was making her way from the deli counter, brown paper turkey in tow. When Gail looked up and saw who was approaching her daughter, skipping toward her sprite-like, she stood there dumbfounded before she started skipping and squealing herself. Everyone always wondered why Michael Jackson never played shows on Thursday evening. Michael Jackson never played shows on Thursday evenings because on Thursday evenings, The Robot Show aired, and he'd be damned if he missed a single episode. The premise was generally appealing to him, inventor dad invents a robot daughter, but it was the nosy neighbor character that he couldn't live without. The nosy neighbor girl with the enormous red pigtails and the different colored Converse, left foot right foot green, and the overalls and the obnoxious, irresistible way she said, hi and bye. Enamored by her comedic timing, like a young Carol Burnett, he mused, he kept his Thursdays sacred and unbooked. Thursdays were for her. And now, here at Gelson's, among sticky spilt lemon, he cowered in Hope's presence. He reached into his Lurex fanny pack and sheepishly pulled out a small worn steno pad and a golf pencil. He asked, bashful and soprano, for her autograph. Gail hadn't gotten close enough to intercept, so she just watched from a few feet away, hoping her daughter would keep her composure among King of Pop. Oh, sure thing, little Hope said. What's your name? Thank you.